Hello there! My name is Megan, and I am a professional artist who lives and works in Los Angeles. I mostly work in the animation industry, but I'm also a visual development artist, illustrator, character designer, and I also work part-time on my social media. I run 4 small-ish, big-ish accounts on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, and here. And recently, I have been getting so many messages from people saying, "How does TikTok work? How do you grow your following? How do I get as many followers as you?" So today's video is going to be about how to grow your social media specifically as an artist. Now, let me get this out of the way right now. I am not going to tell you what you want to hear in this video. Social media is dangerous. I will be giving tips because there's lots of valid reasons to want to grow your following, but I would feel just all sorts of awful if any one of you took my advice and started growing your account and I didn't warn you about all of the sick, unhealthy, awful stuff that comes along with growing social media. So this video comes with a huge disclaimer, warning, do not pass go, yield sign. Okay, so let's start with like the positive part of this video, which are like the tips and tricks and advice. Honestly, it's sort of simple. Let's start with 2 questions. The first question is, what do these social media companies want from you? And the second question is, what is the user experience on these apps? So the answer to the first question, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, Twitter, they all make their money from advertisements. On Facebook and Instagram, every 4th post is a paid advertisement. On Twitter, I think it's like every 10 to 15 posts, but also it's on everyone's profile. On YouTube, it's like all sorts of everywhere. On TikTok, when you open the app, you get an advertisement. And sometimes TikTok will intentionally shut down its own app, so you have to click on the app again and watch another advertisement. So that's their only goal, is to have people stay on their app long enough to be advertised to. So what's the easiest way to make sure that people consistently come back to the app and spend a long time on the app? Well, a stale timeline is a reason why someone might log off. So if there is just a plethora of fresh new content that you've never seen before on your app, then the user is more likely to stay on. So these apps expect from you really, really, really consistent stuff, really consistent posts. For me, that's posting almost every day, but I know a lot of people post like 2 to 3 times a week. So the other aspect to this is all of these companies are competing with each other. Instagram is competing with YouTube, Twitter, Snapchat, and TikTok with Reels, IGTV, what the fuck is it called? I can't even say it. Reels, IGTV, stories, and I guess their captions being really fucking long. Twitter is trying to compete with any short form video app. It's also trying to compete with Instagram and Facebook with stories and Snapchat with stories. Even YouTube has tried to get a like community tab, like stories aspect to compete with things like Facebook or Twitter. So knowing that they're all competing with each other, what do they want from the creator? They want you to use all of their stupid functions. So for Instagram, they want you to use Reels, IGTV. I can't even fucking say that stupid thing. I can't. Reels, that the TV thing, stories, big captions, and normal posts, and the carousel thing. With Twitter, they want you to do the stories, the normal posts, text posts, and post videos. With TikTok, they just want you to post all the time. And YouTube wants you to use the like community tab stories function as well as the videos. That's a lot. Another aspect to this is I mentioned advertising. They want people to stay on their app as long as possible so that they're advertised to. So that means that these companies are tracking how much time you're spending on these apps. If you're spending 8 hours a day on Instagram after you post something, there is no reason for Instagram to serve your videos or your posts because they got what they wanted from you. You got advertised to. But if you post something and leave for 8 hours, don't log into the app, nothing, there's a reason for Instagram to serve your post to give you a bunch of notifications to hopefully lure you back. Instagram does this, TikTok does this, Twitter does this. It's kind of sick, but there's no reason really to sit on Instagram for like 10 hours going like this on your notification bars to see if your post got like a certain amount of likes. You can't even really control how many people get served your video, so you might as well post it and leave for a while and give these apps a reason to try and get you back by serving your videos out. The other thing that I like to keep in mind is that second question and That is, what is the user experience? The sad reality of it is that people are going like this on their phone, scrolling through, and they see your post for like 10 seconds. Even if you post a video that's a minute, 2 minutes, or you have a carousel and you can scroll through, people are not spending that much time with you or your posts. So that's just something to keep in mind. All right, I'm going to very quickly go through like more specifics on each like app. So for TikTok and Reels, they're basically the same thing, except for Reels is a copy of TikTok. The way that the algorithm works for both of these things is that watch time is the most important aspect of your video getting served out or not. When you post something, your video gets served to like 10 people, and if they watch all the way through, then it will get served to more people. If those people watch all the way through, it'll continue to get served until it's done, until your post dies. I would say that comments is like the second thing, the second most important thing to whether or not your video continues to get served out. The way that I navigate this as an artist is to make sure that my shots are like 1 to 3 seconds long, so that the people who are scrolling through with like their lizard brains are like, oh my God, it flashed again after like 2 seconds. I have to keep watching. It keeps people engaged. Another tip I have for that is to not reveal the artwork or like the final artwork until the end. So do close-ups and have you, you know, brushing away at whatever you're working on, drawing away at whatever you're working on, and do close-ups of it until the very end where you reveal it so that people continue to watch all the way through for the end so they have a satisfying ending. Time lapses don't really work in my experience with Reels and TikTok because of, like I said, you don't want to reveal the whole picture right away because you want people to continue to watch. So if you're anything like me and you hate filming yourself while you're working and it like makes you feel paralyzed and you feel like you can't make a mistake, just fake it. For all of my digital artwork, I fake it. I just go through my layers, I turn off some of the top layers, and I'm like, haha, I'm adding brush strokes. And I don't actually like film the process. I just go through my layers and pretend that I'm still working on it until I reveal the full picture at the end. For my traditional work, I actually do film like 1 to 3 second little snippets of the process, but like 99% of the process, I don't have my phone out. I'm just filming little tiny bits of it. The other thing I like to do is do a really quick little like ink drawing. For example, something like this, just like do a really like messy ink drawing and then cut to, oh my God, the final piece. So it can be kind of like a sketch versus final. So you really don't have to film the process of you making something if you don't want to. Filming a whole video of like telling the story of your process as an artist is like a very daunting thing, but it can actually be really simple if you just fake it like I do. For just like normal Instagram outside of Reels, just posting as often as possible, using the stupid little carousel feature, posting to your stories pretty often, even if it's just sharing other people's posts or writing a text post. Okay, let's talk about Twitter. So Twitter is interesting. Their main goal is to kind of start conversations. So anything where you can get a bunch of like quote retweets or a bunch of comments is going to do the best. And a lot of the times that thing is controversial. It's something that people have a lot of opinions about. And when it comes to art, not all of us really want to like do our hot takes on the animation industry every day. So you could post something and say, you know, what do you think of it? Or like, do you like this color palette? You can just post some of your artwork and say, and ask a question along with it that is somewhat relevant to your art. I also like to do work in progresses where I'll be like, I have option A, option B, and do polls. That's something that can be helpful as an artist to like start conversations on Twitter without entering the animation industry discourse. Twitter is also weird in the fact that it will suppress tweets for kind of arbitrary reasons. If you put hashtags in your post, it will get suppressed unless that hashtag is trending. Twitter will suppress any tweet that has a link. Twitter prefers when you do like native videos or native posts. They want people to stay on Twitter and not leave Twitter to go watch a YouTube video or watch a TikTok or whatever. So I would recommend only using hashtags on Twitter if it's trending, and to create mostly native content to the app without linking somewhere else. If you do need to like link your store or something, make your tweet and then add a thread underneath with the links. And then I guess the only other like piece of advice that I really can give with social media is that because people are only spending a couple of seconds with whatever you're posting, try to have some sort of like theme or thing or niche or something that like always appears in your video or posts. It can be a character that shows up a lot of the times. It could be your face. It could be a color that you use all the time, a certain style that you use very regularly. I hate this aspect, but if people see something that they've seen before and it's like the like recognition part of your brain goes off, they're much more likely to interact with whatever you're making because they're like, I've seen something kind of like that before. People follow thousands of people on social media. So what they remember of you, for example, for me, a lot of people think of me as like the bunny girl who draws the bunnies or whatever, or like the cute little creature girl. It's much easier for people to recognize you and want to interact with your posts because you're known for like this thing. I hate that aspect of social media, but like I said, people are only interacting with your posts for like a couple seconds and they're following thousands of people. So try to make yourself in like 5 words or less be known for like that thing. Bunny girl, frog person, artist who draws frogs, artist who always uses like blue in their comics, something like that. All right, guys, this is where I get into the darkness. And I have to bring all of this up because people really lust after having big followings and like, you know, being an influencer or a personality online. But I have to bring this up so people, at least the people who are watching this video, know before they get into any of this wild, buck wild shit. The first thing I need to address when it comes to like the dark side of the internet is that I am pretty sure, like, I'm not gonna say positive. No, you know what? I'm positive. I'm positive that part of why I'm so successful on social media is because I'm a cute white girl who puts their face in a lot of like my posts and videos. And like, I'm not trying to be conceited. I am a very confident person. I like the way I look. I like who I am. But because of like the actual racism that exists on these apps and also like fat phobia, transphobia, all this stuff, me being a cute white girl who's skinny and kind of straight passing because I don't really talk about being bisexual very often, it is much easier for me to grow on social media. The more eyes you have on you, the more people know you, the more followers you have, the less people are going to treat you like a human being. The more people are going to feel like they have the right to make their opinions known about the way you look, who you are, what you're making. The sexism, racism, homophobia, transphobia on these apps is crazy, and the bigger you get, the more likely you are to come across this kind of thing. I can't tell you how many times someone has insulted the way I look, saying that I have fucked up teeth, that body hair on women is gross and unattractive or unnatural. At one point I had someone say that they were worried that I was like manipulating children and I was trying to turn them gay and that was evil of me. And I cannot even imagine what it's like to have larger accounts as a person of color or a black person or a trans person where your existence apparently is a problem for some people in fucking middle America. So I have to say this because, like I said, there are lots of valid reasons to want to grow your social media. But the more eyes you have on you, the more likely you're going to come across these really triggering, awful, bigoted things on the internet. These spaces online might not be safe for you. I have so much privilege looking the way I do, and I have still run into like just like the most awful, negative, bigoted things on the internet because I have a larger following. So unfortunately, there's a lot of other really like negative and dangerous things about social media that I'm about to bring up. The first thing is the gambling. So if you've ever been on TikTok or Reels and made one of them, you've probably noticed how inconsistent your numbers are. Like, you have one video that hits 1 million views, but your next video hits like 30K and you're a little confused. Unfortunately, this is by design and has nothing to do with how good or bad your art is. These companies, on purpose, will blow up one or two of your posts every once in a while to incentivize you to continue to use the app and create content for it. Free content, might I add. So you get a dopamine hit every couple of months because one of these companies will blow up one of your videos so that you continue to work your ass off for free every single day to provide free content for these companies. That's just all sorts of nasty. These companies are literally trying to like manipulate your hormones into you becoming addicted to these apps. The same way that you have addiction to like gambling and like slot machines, you win once, you get that dopamine high, and you want to keep coming back. Social media companies have utilized that system and put it into place in their apps. Let's talk about daily posting. Especially when it comes to art, creating new, unique, and good artwork every single day. I mean, what the fuck? I don't understand, like, that is the most unhealthy and sick standard that I can think of. Making art can be an extremely time-consuming, labor-intensive, and like sometimes traumatizing experience. And these companies want us for free to do it every single day. As an advertisement, I guess, for like our paid content or like our paid, you know, like prints or Etsy or imprint or whatever. It's all sorts of fucked up. It's awful that that is the standard. And it shouldn't be the standard. It's sick. It's awful. It's unhealthy. It's going to hurt people. It probably is hurting people. It's hurting people's mental health and physical health. It physically, you have to fucking go like this or paint something or, you know, sit in your desk chair after your full-time job to create something for Instagram. It's disgusting. But once again, I understand that lots of people want to grow their social media for really valid reasons, the same way I did. So my tip is to milk the absolute shit out of your art. Milk your artwork. Every piece of artwork you get gets like four posts. You get a work in progress, you get a time lapse, you get a reel / TikTok, you get a story, and you get a final piece. And then after like a couple of months, you get to repost it. So I certainly do not recommend making new artwork to post to social media every day because that is absolutely unachievable. But making new artwork every like 4 or 5 days is like somewhat okay. I know that a lot of you are thinking like, oh, it's annoying if I constantly post the same piece of artwork again and again. No, it's not. First of all of your followers didn't see it the first time. And if they see it a second time, it's like, oh, cool. Like, exciting. I like their art. I'm not suddenly going to stop liking their art because I've seen it more than once. So post your art lots of different times in lots of different ways. The other part of posting every day that's just like sick. So I made this post and it got 300 likes. At this point in time, I was probably posting every week-ish or so. And after I changed my posting schedule to posting every day, I posted the exact same piece of artwork and it got 100,000 likes. So in other words, if you're creating like the dopest shit in the entire world and you're like, why doesn't anyone like my work? I must suck. Like, I'm clearly like a bad artist and like no one cares about me. It has nothing to do with the quality of your post. And it has everything to do with how much mindless shit you post onto the internet every single day. Good art does not equal high social media followers. The two things are kind of, honest to God, opposites. The artwork that I spend the least amount of time on always ends up performing better. So the artwork that I spend 20 minutes on versus the artwork I spend, you know, 15 hours on, the stuff that I spend like 10 minutes on is always going to perform better, unfortunately. Don't place your value as an artist on your social media numbers because the value of your artwork and the numbers are completely separate things. I have solved this problem for myself, I guess, by posting artwork that I like kind of fucking hate sometimes. Artwork that doesn't really represent how talented I am. My professional portfolio and the work that I do for work is all sorts of different than the artwork that I post to social media. The stuff I post to social media is very consumable and it doesn't take me a very long time to make. You kind of just have to like weigh the options. Have less social media followers and post stuff that you really like, or post stuff that other people really like that you might not necessarily be a fan of and get lots of followers and likes and views or whatever. That's like a personal thing, but for me, I'm okay with having artwork that I don't think necessarily represents me as an artist on the internet, on my Instagram, as long as my portfolio is accessible and exists, because on my portfolio site, you can see all of like the professional quality work that I do. The other thing about posting every day is that constantly putting like the spotlight on yourself, constantly saying like, I am more important than whatever is going on in the world, and constantly just putting you and your face and your product and the artwork that you spent so much time on out into the world for people to judge, it's just really unhealthy. I recommend finding any way to validate yourself and to place your self-worth on anything other than social media. Your social media is just like a shameless plug for yourself, and that's not a good feeling, especially for people who are very insecure or for people who are super overly confident. I would recommend finding ways to value yourself outside of social media and just treat social media as something that you log into every day to post something and then you never look at it, because that's just a much more healthy experience. Okay, the last thing I have to say, I have been talking so long, my mouth is dry. The biggest periods of growth on your social media that you are going to experience is going to be due to negativity. If you post something that is just a little bit too much of a spicy take, or something that's a little too sexual, or goes against certain social norms, challenges social norms, or if you happen to be a minority and post something that people who are bigoted don't like, you are going to get so much fucking negativity thrown at you. And unfortunately, it's going to be the biggest periods of growth that you're going to see. I'm not a psychologist or anything, but I can't imagine that it's good for you to experience lots and lots of growth and also associate that with like bigotry and negativity. And that's just something I really would like to prepare people for, because I was certainly not prepared when thousands and thousands of sexist people told me that I wasn't allowed to advocate for myself for more money as an artist. I might end up making just like a single video about that topic, because that was surely something. But if you happen to be Black or a woman or Asian and you say something that is just a little bit too spicy for the fucking white trumpets in middle America, you are going to have so many people attacking you in the most bigoted, hateful ways. And unfortunately, that's also going to be the times where you grow the most. And that is a really gross, unhealthy, sick association to negativity and bigotry that I don't think anyone should have a relationship with. It's gross and unhealthy, and I can't imagine what it's done to my brain. Oh my God, my throat hurts. I've been talking forever. I hope this helps. I know I did a fair bit of ranting, but it's hard not to rant about this kind of thing when I constantly put things on the internet, new things on the internet every day. It's hard to spend that much time managing your social media and not be just like, oh, I just have lots of feelings about it. Overall, post really consistently. Get off of the apps after you post. Unfortunately, the quality of your post has nothing to do with how it performs. In general, the internet really isn't a safe place for minorities, and I would recommend finding a support system outside of the internet to help you and support you while going through the really gross negative attention that comes along with having a larger social media. Post super duper often, post every day if you're able to, but don't make new art every day, otherwise you're going to die. And yeah, now that I've talked about social media for a fucking hour, go follow me on TikTok, Instagram, and Twitter, and subscribe to me on here and like this video. God, my fucking voice hurts. I'm so old. I hope this was helpful. If not helpful, I hope I was entertaining to you. Let me know what you want my next video to be about, and I would love to just sit here and rant some more so that you can watch me rant. I hope you have a great rest of your day, and I'll see you later. Goodbye.